And we're live.
Hi, I'm Amy Stephen. I'm an ecologist with the Wisconsin DNR in Madison. I work in the Natural Heritage Conservation Program, and I'm here today to talk to you about using native plants to provide habitat for native wildlife. There was a recent United Nations report that talked a lot about how so many animals across the world are threatened by extinction, in large part due to habitat destruction and loss. And that can be quite disheartening, but it's also empowering to know that regular folks like you and me can make a little difference in helping stave that trend of extinction by providing a little bit of habitat for our native animals wherever we live, either at a small scale in an urban landscape like mine, or in a larger property out in the country. So last year, you guys joined me in July, and we had some different flowers blooming. I think we had spiderwort, among other things that were in flower. But we had requests that you see my garden at a different time of year. And I think this is my favorite time of year in this garden. Spring is when I have the greatest diversity of plants. I'm still working on getting perfect diversification throughout the seasons, but spring is definitely the strong suit in this garden. And so I'm just gonna walk you around and show you some of the flowers that are blooming right now, and we'll also look at some good ground covers. So the first plant you might see behind me, this is called Jacob's Ladder, and I have a picture here and the name. And now we can look over here and you can see that it's got these beautiful blue flowers. It's called Jacob's Ladder because it has leaves that look like they're growing in a ladder. And it can create dense clumps, but it's not, it doesn't spread by runners, it just spreads by seeds. In fact, it spreads quite readily by seed, and if you're happy with that, great. And if not, it's very easy to dig up, and you can put it in a pot and give it to your friend or neighbor. And I don't know if you can see this as Jane videos this, but this is teeming with various insects. We've got small bees, we've got bee flies, and in fact, this is an important plant that provides both nectar and pollen for quite a variety of bees, moths, butterflies, and even the leaves provide food for some moths. So this is a really great pollinator plant. It's also a great workhorse landscape species in that it grows in a variety of soil types. It can tolerate sun to shade to partial shade, and it grows statewide. So this is a perfect plant to grow in any garden in Wisconsin. One of my favorites, Jacob's Ladder. All right, our next flower that's blooming right now is Shooting Star, and I'll show you a picture firsthand, and then we'll look at it in the garden. So Shooting Star. And this is a really interesting plant in that it has a unique form of pollination. So there are only a few insects that can pollinate it, including some bumblebees and other types. And it's called buzz pollination. And you can see in this picture that the bee actually has to suspend itself from below the flower, and then it has to somehow vibrate its wing muscles without vibrating its wings, and that shakes the pollen off, and that provides an important food source for the bees. And of course, some of the pollen gets transferred to other plants and pollination occurs. So that's pretty cool.
We have one question, Amy.
Uh-huh.
David wants to know where seeds can be obtained.
Okay, so at the end of this piece, I'm going to tell you where to find more information, but I'll give you a little tip that we have a special web page where we provide a list of different native plant nurseries around the state. And but I'll tell you right now too, and we can repeat it at the end. So if you go to dnr.wi.gov, and then when you get to the search box, you type in native plants, and that will take you to a plant that's actually a pollinator page, but it has all kinds of information along these lines, including a list of native plant nurseries.
Awesome.
All right, that's a great question. I'm glad that you're asking that because that means when I get out and go buy some plants. It's wonderful. So if we look in the garden behind us, you can see the shooting stars. And Jane, you might note that we've got ones that are lavender, ones that are white, and they can even be deep purple. And these were all plants purchased from the same place, and yet they have a variety of colors even within this small population. In my garden, they seed in quite readily. We've even got them growing in the driveway median. And so these are ones that I like to give away to friends as well. Just beautiful plants, early spring bloomers. These also could theoretically be grown statewide. In general, they're known more in southern Wisconsin or south of the tension zone, but there are populations known far to the north, so I don't think that temperature is a limiting factor. So definitely a good one, probably statewide. So I thought I'd tell you a little bit about some good ground covers too that I have in my gardens. Ground covers can help us capture a lot of space, so we don't have to do a lot of weeding. It prevents the soil from eroding. This plant here is one of my favorites for sunny areas. This is called prairie smoke, and I don't have a picture of that, so you just have to look at it in the video. But this is in the rose family, and that flower doesn't really open up much. But once it goes to seed, it makes this really adorable little fluffy thing that looks like a troll doll hair. They're just kind of, and that's why it's called prairie smoke. It almost looks like they're smoking. And these make a very nice ground cover. So that's for sunny areas. And over here, if you follow me, we have wild ginger that I'm going to show you. And this is my favorite ground cover for shady areas. So this is wild ginger, and it has beautiful heart-shaped leaves. It actually has really weird little flowers down at the base. I'll just pull one, so you've got plenty of it. And that is actually pollinated by flies, but it's a very diminutive flower. But this makes just a beautiful ground cover. I don't find it to be aggressive in my garden. And if it does spread in places where I don't want it, I don't find it difficult to dig up and give to a friend or a neighbor. While we're here, look at this cute little prairie trillium or red trillium. It grows mostly in woods and shade, so I don't know why it's called prairie trillium. I think red trillium is a better name. That's a native wildflower. Everything in here is native wildflowers. And then I want to show you another, bad time for lawn mowing.
Well, we do have one question we can answer.
Yeah.
Cherise says, I'm wondering how to get a lawn converted to prairie, but we have 2 acres at least, and I don't want to use Roundup.
Okay. Well, I can think of several methods without herbicide. Now, certainly in small settings and not 2 acres, people will lay down black plastic, and you can put that down for 1 to 2 years. Now, at two acres, that's not practical. You certainly can cultivate soil. Just get a rototiller. You could even get a sod cutter, maybe. I don't know what kind of grass you have, and just remove that sod and just keep cultivating that soil and make sure that you get all of the weeds out before you plant prairie. One of the most important steps in prairie restoration is the site preparation. And if you skimp on that part and you have weeds to start with, you're going to have weeds all going down the line. So it's best to take even a few years to prep your site if you need to. Another method, if you're out in the country and maybe you have smooth brome grass, like in a CRP, you can repeatedly burn that grass safely, maybe with the help of professionals. And after you burn it, you can throw prairie seeds on that. Do that year after year after year, and with annual burning, that can actually break down that smooth brome sod and allow those seeds to get incorporated. You can also use a rake and scratch those seeds in so they get good seed to soil contact. And then just keep it mowed. So with any prairie planting, you want to keep it mowed to a level of 6 inches while those prairie plants are getting established in their first 2 or 3 years. So if you need any more information on prairie restoration, there's a great book that you could get at the library called The Tallgrass Restoration Handbook by Steve Packard and Connie Mutel. I recommend that highly. So, and now our neighbor's lawnmower has moved to the back. Let's hope he stays back there. And there was one other ground cover that I want to show you over here. It's Maidenhair Fern. So we actually have it in here. It's my favorite fern. It's just a delicate fern. It's kind of unique in that it kind of grows in an arc rather than an upright clump. And this will also grow statewide, and it prefers shade. Any ferns really make good crown covers. You'll see in the background that I have ostrich ferns too. And these are amazing ground covers. And if you have an area where you don't want anything else to grow, these are a good choice. They can be pretty aggressive, and I have to keep digging them up, otherwise my whole garden would be covered with these. So I would recommend these with caution, but they're beautiful and easy to grow. Okay, and I see my hedge trimmers here, which reminds me that I wanted to give you a little tip. So with the Jacob's ladder, those create seed heads later in the season, and I actually don't find them to be that attractive, and especially right here in my front garden, my front entryway. So what I do is I actually take my hedge trimmers and I just chop those seed heads off, and there's always some seed heads that remain lower down, and so I always get some propagation, and that's fine because I do like to have little Jacob's ladder babies that I can move around or give away to friends. I also use the hedge trimmers if I have a prairie garden where some plants are getting too tall. I just keep them, you know, at a certain level where I know that if they are allowed to get too tall, sometimes they flop over. So I just use my hedge trimmers and chop their heads off. Best to do that before they flower. So there's another good tip. Let's see, I think that was all I was going to show you guys, but I did want to say, I forgot what my other points were. Oh yeah, handout. So I recently developed a handout, and it's kind of like a starter for anyone who wants to get started with native plants. And this is like a top 10 list of native wildflowers and plants that can be grown statewide, that are readily available at nurseries across the state. And I tried to provide examples that flower in the spring, summer, and fall. And it is best if we can get representation of flowering plants throughout the seasons to accommodate all the different animals' needs throughout the year. So again, if you go to dnr.wi.gov and then type in native plants, you can find this resource. My colleague Ryan Brady also made a great similar resource that talks about plants and for bird habitat. And there are so many great resources at that webpage, where the native plant nurseries are, different wildlife values. So I encourage you to look at that page. And let's all do our part to help promote habitat for our native wildlife.